David, thank you very much indeed for that. And can I thank the Global MSC team for inviting me here today? 30 different countries, that's absolutely fantastic. Many of you will know and will have heard of me beforehand, but for those who don't, building on David's very generous introduction, I was a former intelligence officer with the British military at a very senior level for many years. And I bring that into my journalist career now to be able to inform on different things that have happened. And today I want to talk to you about biometrics and CCTV as a win-lose combination from a former intelligence officer's perspective. But I'm going to use as a vehicle the story around the Novichok poisonings in Salisbury. Now, who'd have ever thought that a couple of years ago when Novichok was first used, we'd now be into a biological pandemic that is changing our lives. The world is certainly an interesting place. So today, biometrics, do they help or do they hinder?
Investigators are now retracing the victim's steps to get a better idea.
And how did they deploy it?
Could have been somewhere like the ventilation system of their car. So it was contained within that shell.
Find that needle in the haystack.
The most likely route is that someone during his walk through Salisbury has rushed past him and wiped this on his skin.
It could have been a poison or a toxin that was ingested.
They are fast acting.
Was it ingested? Was it airborne?
It only required the tiniest of doses.
Experts point out the Russians have a long history of developing and using undetectable poisons,
but officials are not directly blaming Russia so far.
For the first time, a weapon of mass destruction by a state sponsor of terrorism has been employed against one of our allies.
So that's the introduction to episode 2 of the BBC series, The Salisbury Poisonings, that I understand are going to be broadcast in the United States this fall. And if you haven't seen it, I think it's still on BBC iPlayer, well worth watching, because it gives you the human story behind what could have been written for a James Bond movie without any problems whatsoever. So taking you back in history, we go back to the early March in 2018, when two individuals flew into Gatwick Airport. And in the bottom right-hand corner of the slide there, you can see them coming through the passenger control on their way in. Went up to London and stayed at in a little bed and breakfast, the picture of which you can see at the top right of the corner, and then of the slide. And then they took the train down to Salisbury on the Saturday to have a little look around. And you can see them coming out of the airport, and then in the bottom left-hand corner going out through Salisbury railway station. Now, Salisbury, very interesting. It's very close to the UK's chemical defence establishment at Porton Down. And that was one of the reasons why Salisbury was probably chosen as a potential target area. But you can see the pictures that I'm pulling together there are from CCTV, more of which in a moment. So what then happened was on the Saturday, they went and had a little look at the house where you can see the police car or the police Land Rover sitting outside in the middle that just happened to belong to an individual called Sergei Skripal. Sergei Skripal had been a former colonel in Russian military intelligence, the GRU, their oldest intelligence organization. But he had defected and had been working for MI6 for a number of years and had been resettled back in the UK after he was released from Russian prison as part of a prisoner exchange. Nobody expected him to be targeted. The Russians had pardoned him. He was put as a relatively low risk, but geopolitical events that were going on at the time, this happened exactly 14 days before the Russian presidential election. President Vladimir Putin had never been quiet in the press about his lack of support for those that had betrayed Mother Russia. And he wanted to do something that influenced the global community by stopping dissenters from interfering with his position in the election, but also to be able to then build on that and try and get a populist support amongst the Russian people. Again, you can see from the pictures there, the three in the bottom left-hand corner are all from local CCTV. More in a moment. So CCTV and the GRU. We have CCTV coverage of the two GRU agents using false identities coming in through Gatwick. That's been identified quickly. We have CCTV coverage, bottom right, of the same two GRU agents going through Salisbury Railway Station on the Saturday and the Sunday. Question. They were through London. They'll have gone out through Waterloo Railway Station. There are CCTV and all the trains on that. Where's the CCTV coverage that there is for that? Now, this is an ongoing and live investigation, so not everything that the security services or the police have will have been released into the public domain. But there's a question mark over what's there. We then go on to the left-hand side of the slide, and we see CCTV from public sector CCTV around Salisbury. We then see other public sector, and then at the top left-hand corner, some CCTV from a shop where the two individuals had been looking at some coins in the window. So we're seeing a real mixture of public, private, and CCTV deployed in critical national infrastructure situations, and we're building up a good picture. And the security services and the police managed to pull this together very quickly indeed. Not as quickly as it seems as the investigative journalist site Bellingcat, who very quickly identified the two individuals as Colonel Dr. Alexander Mishkin and Colonel Chepegi of the GRU. They publicly put out an awful lot of detail behind them from what could be found through open source intelligence perspectives. But with the CCTV that we've got through there, there are a number of questions, because the individuals on the Saturday spent a little bit of time in Salisbury. Nobody has clarified who else they met, potentially. Now, from an intelligence perspective, carrying out this sort of operation, they won't have randomly gone onto the train and randomly gone down and had a quick look for themselves and decided to come back the next day and wipe a bit of Novichok on the front door of Sergei Skripal's house. There would have been a big preparation operation going on beforehand, where teams would have gone in, they'll have reconnaissance the area, they'll have checked that Sergei Skripal hadn't invited all the neighbours around for a big barbecue on the Saturday night or the Sunday morning. They'll have known Yulia was coming in. They wouldn't have been looking at the other friends that were there. So there's an awful lot more information that has not come out into the public domain. It could be part of the investigation. It could be that there wasn't the joining together of the CCTV systems in the way that we would expect in a modern society. And actually, if you go into Salisbury and look at it, at the time there was a brand new CCTV system had been put in across the city, but there was a little bit of a dispute going on between Salisbury City Council and Wiltshire Council, and Wiltshire Council had put it in as to who was funding the whole system. And that was, whilst the system was working, there were frictions that had happened in discussing the funding of a system and how it was going to be managed and looked at that may or may not have had an impact on its complete serviceability. Something to bear in mind whenever we're negotiating the business side of things. Just to finish it off, unfortunately, you know, after Chepega and Mishkin had left the country several months later, whilst the World Cup was going on in Russia, Charlie Rowley on the right picked up a bottle of what he thought was perfume. He was a homeless man and had kept it as a present for his girlfriend, Dawn Sturges, on the left. And unfortunately, when he gave it to her on her birthday, she spread it on her wrists, and it wasn't a perfume bottle. It contained Novichok. However, you have to question why it was still in a sealed packet in a sealed container if it had been used beforehand. And if it was in a sealed packet and sealed container had been used, what happened to the container that had been used? And what happened to the protective equipment that the GRU agents will have been wearing? Because this stuff is deadly. It's designed to injure first and kill second, but it is deadly in the tiniest amounts. So we get a picture of the GRU guys, and Bellingcat put together an absolutely fantastic investigation where they outed their whole careers. They found that they had been given huge medals by President Putin. They had distinguished careers in the Russian military and Russian military intelligence. And when that was exposed, they then went on to RT.com and gave a little briefing saying that, no, they were just there to see the tower, the famous tower in Salisbury, because they had read so much about it. But the weather, both of them had come from Russia where the snow was measured in tens of metres, not just metres. The weather and the snow had stopped them from exploring where they wanted to go to, so they came back again. The Russians have a doctrine that they call Voranya, which is telling a story which you know nobody's going to believe, but nobody's going to question to try and excuse what you've done. They did that. We saw President Putin coming out with lots of statements about it must have escaped from Porton Down. It was the British what did it. It was the Americans what did it. It was someone else what did it. The Russians have got another doctrine for that, and that's called maskarovka and masking. Donald Trump, who won't be in position for much longer, calls that fake news. It's nothing new. But given the power of the internet and the power of social media, it is a real weapon and can influence people's thinking. And Vladimir Putin will have been sitting in Moscow with a white cat on his lap, with a very large glass of vodka over ice behind his big desk, sipping it slowly, watching the debate going on in UK Parliament where the conclusions by the British government that the Russians were behind it were actually being questioned by MPs sitting in Parliament and doing Vladimir Putin's job for him instead of harmonising the world to try and hold him to task for what's happening. Now, that's the what happened behind it and all the rest of it. But there's a few things that come into here from the AI, from the CCTV and from the analytics perspective that I want to bring out. And they can be for the good or they can be for the bad. They can be for the good in looking at how these investigations can be put together. We have on that slide a fantastic set of images from across the years that can be put together and fed into AI to bring up a perfectly good model that could be used to track the movement of these individuals across the place. It may have happened. Because it's an active investigation, I don't know, and I don't think we'll know, because sufficient evidence has been released for the Crown Prosecution Service to bring charges against the individuals, and for that to flag up an Interpol red notice asking for their extradition. For those that don't know about the Interpol red notices looking for their extradition and a combined European arrest warrant, Russia does not recognise the use of the red notice against any Russian citizen and will not extradite anyone from Mother Russia to any other part of the world to answer for their charges. Russia is also one of the most prolific users of Interpol red notices to get Russian dissenters arrested across the globe and sent back to Russia. Double standards or what? But we've got a good CCTV picture. We've got a good picture of where people are moving as they go around this. And if we combined in with that a little bit of what we recognise from an analytics perspective, from a facial recognition analytics perspective, then it shouldn't be difficult to get all of the capability that's there, put it together through a smart piece of video analytics with AI built on top of it and track these individuals. Especially when you look at the little symbol I've got on the picture of the passport in the centre, because that's a biometric passport, a biometric identity document. And across the globe, all of the border forces are building up this biometric picture that there is of everyone as they travel around internationally. Fantastic. That aids the investigation. That gives us the tools that we need to do it. This is a subject that I know Tony Porter is very well aware of and has some concerns about the use of biometric data, and is something that I think we can bring up in questions, and I'd love to hear the views of everyone out there as to what you think should be used here, because that's fantastic from an investigative perspective. However, I'm an intelligence officer. Now, my organisation, luckily, very rarely had to put people in incognito to do things, but the two GRU individuals came in incognito. If their biometric profile is on a database somewhere, is that good for being a spy? Not necessarily, because as soon as you walk through with a different passport and a different identity, and that flags up, it'll flag up that you are not who you say you are. So from an espionage perspective, biometric and AI identity is not a good thing. From an investigative perspective, it's fantastic and can help enormously. So, as we get into the reality and we get greater processing power and AI starts to take over and we look at the improvement in the imagery, the image of me on the right is a complete 3D scan and it can do a complete body scan. We can get away from just facial recognition technology and into full body recognition technology. But we need to look at the implications from a privacy perspective and where your biometric identity is held and how it's managed from a personal privacy perspective, and to make sure that it cannot be abused in any way, shape or form. So that's balance between what's good for the state and what's good for the individual. Biometrics and national security, how do we control it? It's not just facial recognition. You've got iris scanning, you've got voice scanning, you've got fingerprints. It's a debate. And it's a debate that we have to have, and we have to have soon, because the technology is there today to make this happen. I look forward to chatting to you and answering as many questions as I can through the question session that we have at the end of today. Thank you very much indeed.